sitting here in the museum and this wonderful, with all this Indian art around you, feeling so wonderful that just, I wondered what my ancestors would have thought of me receiving this award from this institution. Growing up with my grandparents, I didn't know that there was, that I thought that was the way everybody lived. And so it was a warm, nurturing family situation until I went to school and read Dick and Jane and their dog and whatever. Lived in an ordinary family. And that kind of came as a shock to me. Grandfather rarely spoke, he could curse in English, but he didn't speak Comanche. I mean, he spoke Comanche all the time. Grandmother would go back and forth, but mostly everyone spoke Comanche at home. And so I had to learn to speak English. I could speak some English, but it was about like Grandpa. It was so broken that you, it was so poor that it, I didn't learn how to speak really until I went to school. My grandfather and my grandmother both were very, very strong. And grandmother had a lot of faith in me. And I remember going to her when I was little. Someone had hurt my feelings at school by calling me some derogatory term. And I told her about it, and she said, oh, said, don't pay any attention. They don't understand. They're kind of like, bless your heart, as we used to say. My grandfather just idolized Roosevelt because he had gone through the Depression, and he would use a curse word in front of President Hoover's name. And I thought that was his first name for a long time. But they voted. They would, in their, you know, their Comanche clothes, and go, and they'd go to the polls and vote, be the first ones to vote. They took a great deal of pride of being vote because of the Great Depression. And that was what they remembered. And it, they were affected not as bad as most people, because he was a real good farmer, and he became, if you can imagine a Comanche becoming a good farmer, we were being nomadic and all. But he became, because my great-great-grandfather put all of our land allotments. You know, we didn't have reservations in Oklahoma, we had allotments. And he put them all together my grandfather would work all of the younger siblings' land. So we were a little better off. Grandfather was a Peyote man, he didn't go to the church, but he drove us to church. But so I started questioning people who were trying to convince me that this was right and this was wrong. And Comanche way, there is, you know, there's no right or wrong, or you don't have the complete truth. No one has the complete truth. So I started asking questions about what they were trying to get me to be. I think I was around 11 years old when I decided that they didn't know the truth any more than I did. Other than my great-grandmother, now she was the matriarch of the all of us, and she would sit like an empress in her chair. She was, of course, quite elderly when I was, but being the matriarch, she gave the commands, more or less. I mean, she told us all what we should be doing and how we should behave, but she did it in such a graceful way, and some way a little intimidating. I was always intimidated by her, but I'd love to sit by her and listen to her tell us, you know, tell the adults what they should be doing, mostly. So with my great-grandmother and my mother, my grandmother took her place. And then I got to thinking that mother was quite a heroine. That fact, she could leave the comfort of her family to have to live in a dormitory. And so she was in the time when people had to make the transition of getting jobs and not living on the farm and going away from home and all that. So she became a heroine of mine. It was my Comanche family, because they were always so loving and so affectionate. They were there and, you know, to take care of you. And I was kin to everybody, you know. I felt like I was kin to, because they would call me by a kinship name, as we do. And call me by a kinship name when they weren't even related to me. I married my high school sweetheart. We were in high school together, and got married right after when he graduated and went off to college. The following year we got married. And he was interested in Indian culture and could learn to, and he learned to try to speak the language. And so that reinforced my sense of self. And he came from a poor farm background and then became a state senator. He was a lawyer and a state senator and United States senator. So it's that kind of rapid movement that the transition from coming from the farm and then the culture shock of being in Washington, D.C. and trying to understand that culture. When I went to Washington, I felt like, my goodness, they don't know anything about Indians. So, you know, I could just almost say anything and then nobody could disprove what I said because they didn't have any facts. It was a learning, totally learning experience, organizing Oklahomans for Indian Opportunity. That happened in my living room. And then we, you know, became a statewide organization. But it seemed natural. It seemed things that you were supposed to do because you were a Comanche. Because you were a Comanche, you were supposed to organize people to take care of them, help to take care of themselves. Organizing Oklahomans for Indian Opportunity and working on civil rights at home, it was just a step up to a national platform from a statewide platform. In the 50s, they said the Indian was the vanishing race. There were books written about it, you know, scholars written about it. And here we come back, we're stronger and smarter and more efficient than we were even before then. So because we've come to see ourselves in this positive way and have created all these different things that are making us strong. And it doesn't make us better than anyone else, but it makes us more equal so that we can participate in what's happening around us and put our values, insert our values into it so that it's more balanced. I always think first of the return of the Taos Blue Lake to the Taos people, because it started in the 60s, it started the trend of returning land to Indians. It was the first big land settlement. And the success of it brought about the Menominee Restoration and the Alaskan Claim Settlement. And it showed that we could succeed if we band together and be supportive of each other. And to me, that was a major step.